Blackstone Audio presents Suspect Red by L.M. Elliott. This book is read by Elizabeth Wiley. For Peter and Megan, standard bearers for integrity, eloquence, and freedom of thought.
Communism is a malignant and evil way of life, akin to disease. So long as school boards and parents tolerate conditions whereby communists and fellow travelers, under the guise of academic freedom, can teach our youth a way of life that eventually will destroy the sanctity of the home, that undermines faith in God, that causes them to scorn respect for constituted authority.
FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover.
This is the time of the Cold War, when all the world is split into two vast, increasingly hostile armed camps. When a great democracy is destroyed, it will not be because of enemies from without, but rather because of enemies from within. There are no degrees of loyalty in the United States. A man is either loyal or he is disloyal. We must be sure that those who seek to lead us today are equally dedicated. We cannot survive on half loyalties any more than we can find the facts of conspiracy with half truths.
Senator Joseph McCarthy.
McCarthyism is the corruption of truth, the abandonment of the due process of law. It is the use of the big lie and the unfounded accusation against any citizen in the name of Americanism or security. It is the spread of fear.
Former President Harry S. Truman. Chapter 1, June 1953.
Julius and Ethel Rosenberg are executed in the electric chair for espionage, despite appeals to the Supreme Court and President Dwight D. Eisenhower for clemency. Their trial follows a string of spying cases involving British and American diplomats and other federal workers. The Rosenbergs are convicted of giving U.S. atomic bomb technology to the Soviet Union. Many believe the Soviets would not have developed their A-bomb without the Rosenbergs' help. Reporters follow their sons Robert, 6, and Michael, 10, to Sing Sing prison for their final goodbyes, while newspaper headlines shout, "Atom bomb spies die silent to the end. Couple display no emotion as they pay for betraying their nation." Workers in East Berlin go on strike. They also march for reunification of their city, calling for an end to the Soviet Union's control of the German capital's eastern sector. The policed dividing line between democratic and communist Germany had been established after the defeat of Hitler in a post-World War II stalemate between the two new superpowers, Stalin's Soviet Union and the United States, with its NATO allies Great Britain and France. Soviet tanks crush the East Berliners' plea for democracy and reunion with their family, friends, and neighbors. The symbolic Iron Curtain becomes a deadly barrier. Within a few years, the Soviets will build the fortified Berlin Wall. Thousands of East Berliners will die trying to cross it. The Red Scare spreads to books. Convinced that hidden communist themes could pervert American thoughts, aides to Red Hunter Senator Joseph McCarthy remove subversive books written by communists, fellow travelers, etc., from State Department and embassy libraries overseas. Hundreds of books are torched in bonfires. Across the United States, libraries pull suspect books from shelves. Some civilians also burn novels by authors who focus on the plight of the working class, such as John Steinbeck. the New Republic magazine runs a cover story explaining who is being censored. The following Americans have been mentioned unfavorably in testimony before the House Un-American Activities Committee, HUAC, or cited as belonging to one or more fronts. Present directives indicate that their works should be withdrawn from U.S. libraries overseas and that they should not be subjects or authors of feature articles or broadcasts. The 64 names include physicist Albert Einstein, novelist Ernest Hemingway, Pulitzer Prize-winning author Upton Sinclair, and New Yorker columnist Dorothy Parker. Richard settled down at the kitchen table. Under his armpit was a book, in his hand a cup of chastened Sanborn he'd poured himself, curious. He took a sip and made a face at the instant coffee's bitter taste. Good grief! Why the heck does Dad drink this junk? He shoved the cup aside and put his novel on the table. School was out, summer was on, and Richard had a stack of books he planned to read. Stuff that would obliterate all the crumb-bum melodrama of junior high school, including the cliques that froze out a kid who liked to read and couldn't roller skate, the girls who went steady with dopes who greased their hair into duck butts, and who turned their pretty freckled noses up at a guy who talked about the Holy Grail or Sherlock Holmes or Sam Spade. In September, Richard would wade back into that donkey manure, but this summer, Richard was going to escape. He'd travel universes brought to life by his books, no moldy old mush dictated by school wardens. Good stuff, heroes, spy intrigues, quests, underdogs winning the day, private detectives cracking crime cases, and a couple of dames in distress. He'd even squirreled away a copy of that novel all the parents hated, The Catcher in the Rye. He was reading Salinger's story in chunks at midnight with a flashlight, knowing it was dangerous stuff. Last night, the 16-year-old narrator, Holden Caulfield, ran away from boarding school after getting his nose busted by a jerk in his dorm. Richard pulled out the pocket-sized spiral notebook in which he'd jotted down things that he really liked. He reread some Holden truths he'd copied. You could always tell a moron. They never want to discuss anything intelligent. Richard nodded. Exactly. What really knocks me out is a book that, when you're all done reading it, you wish the author that wrote it was a terrific friend of yours, and you could call him up on the phone whenever you felt like it. Write again. Sometimes books could be better friends than kids. No joking. Richard ran his hand along the forest green cover of the novel he'd brought to the kitchen table, Robin Hood. Classic stuff. He'd love to talk to the guy who wrote it. Richard had read the book before, but the story never got old. How could it? A former knight, now outlaw, hanging out with forest desperados, taking down a bully, and winning the prettiest maiden in the land. Richard smiled down at the cover and its N.C. Wyeth illustration of the legendary Merry Men. Standing among a thick grove of trees, they glowered out menacingly. Robin leaned on a longbow, and a green feather festooned his emerald cap, illuminated by an arrow of light piercing the dense forest canopy. Richard opened to where he'd reluctantly left off the day before, when he'd been called down for dinner. Tuna casserole, the worst. Now, it was early morning, everyone was asleep. No interruptions. Richard began to read. Instantly, he no longer sat in a tidy, perfectly symmetrical brick colonial in Northwest Washington, D.C. Instead, he stalked the gloom of Sherwood Forest in the age of the Crusades. He came upon an ambush. It was a wild spot, and only the notes of the birds and the rush of the falling water disturbed it. But ere they had proceeded a quarter of a mile up the bank of the stream, a sudden bend in it brought them the harsh noise of desperate and near fighting.
Our arrows must do duty for us then, muttered Robin grimly, soon as he understood this. Fit shafts across your bows, friends, and aim with all your hearts in it.
They dropped to their knees and, Richard! Richard flinched. Sherwood Forest evaporated. His mother.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.